Hi, I am Abhik Majumdar, Assistant Professor, National University, Odisha. In this lesson, we shall discuss certain post-Hart developments in legal positivism. H.L. Hart, as we know, made seminal contributions to the positivist philosophy of law. He broke away from classical positivism's reliance on empiricism and the so-called common theory of law, and instead postulated the idea of laws as rules. He also transformed our perception of rules by highlighting their internal as well as external aspects. Furthermore, he classified rules into two categories, primary and secondary. Secondary rules he defined as rules about primary rules, and then he classified them into three types, namely rules of recognition, rules of adjudication, and rules of change. He then postulated that legal systems must have an ultimate rule of recognition whose existence can neither be proved nor disproved, but only accepted as a rule by officials through convention, as it were. Not surprisingly, this provoked much controversy, particularly from Hart's greatest detractors, including Ronald Dworkin. Interestingly, though, these insights of H.L. Hart have also served as a basis of much new thinking within the framework of positivism. Largely, they have emerged as a response by positivism adherents, mostly though not exclusively students of Hart, to criticism leveled by detractors of positivism. This lesson is dedicated to such developments, that is, developments within positivist thought undertaken in the wake of Hart's seminal contribution. Here we discuss three such selected developments. Substantive and methodological positivism. The term methodological positivism has been prevalent from some time in other disciplines like sociology. Its use in jurisprudence, however, seems to have been originated with the theorist Stephen Perry. In a 1996 article, we find him using this term. This article may be described as an extended review of W.J. Waluchow's inclusive legal positivism. There he makes the following claim: Waluchow is, like H.L. Hart, both a methodological and a substantive positivist. Also like Hart, he does not always distinguish as well as clearly as he might between the two types of positivist theory. Be that as it may, Perry himself does not specify here how the two are different. It is in another article, first published in 1998 and then subsequently included in the book Hart's Postscript, that he outlines their difference. He defines substantive positivism as the view that there is no necessary connection between morality and the content of law. Methodological positivism, on the other hand, entails the view that legal theory can and should offer a normatively neutral description of a particular social phenomenon, namely law. That is the claim that there is no connection, necessary or otherwise, between morality and legal theory. Perry also advances the claim that the respective claims of the two forms are, at least on the surface, logically independent, and cites as examples Hobbes and Bentham, who employed normative methodology to defend versions of substantive positivism. In other words, substantive positivism can be treated as a restatement of the separability thesis, namely that there is no necessary connection between law and morality, while methodological positivism suggests that explanation of legal phenomena can be generated from without having to adopt any moral position. In a way, this is a throwback to Hart's own theoretical contributions and how they may be observed to have changed over time. Back in 1961, in the concept of law as it originally stood, he had defined positivism in the following terms. Here we shall take legal positivism to mean the simple contention that it is in no sense a necessary truth that laws reproduce or satisfy certain demands of morality, though in fact they have often done so. This is a clear enunciation of the separability thesis, that is, a separation between morals and law itself, and not the study of law, and hence can be understood as an expression of what Perry calls substantive positivism. On the other hand, in the postscript added to the 1994 second edition, he advanced the claim that my aim in this book was to provide a theory of what law is, which is both general and descriptive. He characterized general as not being tied to any particular legal system or culture, in its endeavor of generating an explanatory and clarifying account of law. By descriptive, he meant that his endeavor is morally neutral and has no justificatory aims. It does not seek to justify or comment on moral or other grounds the forms and structures which appear in my general account of law. Here his emphasis lies on the generation of a general and descriptive theory of law, that is the study of law rather than law itself. In this sense then, the perspective can be considered an expression of methodological positivism. Perry also agrees that this claim is very good evidence that he meant to adopt a framework of methodological positivism. The story does not end there. Perry identifies two varieties of methodological positivism, namely what he terms the descriptive explanatory method and the method of conceptual analysis. He then claims that only the first amounts to a positivist, that is morally neutral theory. The second, he contends, is nothing but a form of Dworkin's interpretive approach. But first, what are these forms of methodological positivism? Perry begins by postulating that there are two possibilities how we may identify a social phenomenon as law. The first is to study it from an external objective point of view, that is something like a scientist observing a natural phenomenon. This is what he calls the descriptive explanatory approach. The second possibility involves us analyzing our own concept of law, that is what we as participants inside a legal system understand by the term law. This entails examining our own social practices and how we categorize some as law and so on. Such an approach seems akin to the hermeneutic or internal viewpoint approach Hart advocated in his rejection as useless of a science derived empirical methodology for the study of law. As such, Perry agrees that Hart's method is not of the descriptive explanatory type, though he does discern elements of the latter in Hart's philosophy, such as his use of the term descriptive sociology to characterize his theory of law. Hence, he ultimately classifies Hart's methodology as conceptual analysis, but of singular type, that is conceptual analysis from an external rather than internal point of view. This appears to pose a problem. Perry acknowledges that a purely descriptive explanatory approach can be general, that is normatively neutral in character, but he asks, what does it mean to say that legal theory is general when your methodology is some form of conceptual analysis? Perry's response to his own question is to indicate that Hart's theory is not really as general as it is claimed to be. To start with, Hart distinguishes modern municipal legal systems from more primitive ones. But what is the basis on which he does so? Perry points out that Hart invokes for this purpose the English legal system and others, which are broadly similar in structure in spite of important differences. From this, he infers that Hart's theory is local as opposed to general, in a way similar to Dworkin's theories, and concludes from there that Hart's and Dworkin's methodologies lose the appearance of an unbridgeable gulf. Perry next characterizes as an evaluative claim Hart's view that Hart's view that a regime exclusively made of primary rules has defects which are removed by incorporating secondary rules, particularly the rule of recognition. This is not entirely without precedent. Stephen Guest, for example, contends somewhat tenuously that Hart's distinction between primitive and modern municipal legal systems implies that it is in some sense good, that is morally good, to understand the second to be superior to the first. But how does Perry substantiate his contentions that Hart's external conceptual analysis method is inadequate? To cut a long story short, he does so by first claiming that viewed in methodological terms then, Hart's project appears to clarify from an external perspective our shared concept of law, focusing in particular on the idea that law purports to bind us through authoritative acts. He then identifies three related parts in which such a theory can be divided, namely A, a general account of obligation; B, legal concepts such as authority, state, legislation, etc., etc.; And finally, C, analysis of the concept of law itself. Next, he takes up each concept separately and examines how Hart treats each separately. In each case, he finds Hart's treatment to be inadequate. For example, Hart's account for obligation cannot really be considered an analysis. This is because it does not offer a normative account as to when, if ever, social rules do really create obligations, as opposed to the perception of obligations. Hart's observations about people regarding themselves as obligated does not elucidate whether or not they are in fact obligated. Hence, since Hart's account of obligation is merely a descriptive statement that some members of a group at certain times regard themselves as obligated, it cannot be regarded as a proper analysis. Perry concludes by saying that this statement, that is, about members of a group regarding themselves as obligated, uses rather than analyzes the concept of obligation. Hart's account of the other parts are also similarly scrutinized and found to be inadequate. For example, as in the case of Hart's account of obligation, it is not clear that his account of the concepts of authority, validity, and so on is in any significant sense properly designated as an analysis. That is so, at least as long as he insists on sticking with an external, purely descriptive theoretical perspective. Perry then concludes by making the important claim that the issues of the law's authority, etc., can be resolved either by taking a skeptical point of view, that is, by claiming the law does not and cannot give rise to obligations, or by attributing a function to law and then examining how these functions could provide those within the legal system certain reasons for action that they would otherwise not have. But this effectively amounts to Dworkin's interpretive attitude outlined in Law's Empire, which in turn connects Dworkin's famous characterization of justification as concerning how to make the best possible moral sense of a practice from the participant's point of view. In other words, internal conceptual analysis of these legal notions from a non-skeptical perspective compels taking into account the purpose of law and interpreting it in the best moral sense. Not surprisingly, Perry's views have come in for a lot of criticism from both exclusive and inclusive positivists. For example, the theorist Leighton Moore put together an extensive rebuttal of Stephen Perry, and he contends that Perry misunderstood Hart's objective. The main problem with Perry's argument, as I see it, is that it too hastily rejects the possibility that Hart's primary intention was to describe legal institutions rather than make explicit what we already subjectively understand by terms such as law and legal systems. He also claims that Perry's appreciation of internal conceptual analysis is both different in form and narrower in character than Hart's is. Most interestingly, Hart himself had laid down the foundations for a rebuttal. While his rejection of empirical and scientific method has already been referred to, in the postscript to the concept of law, he distinguishes between describing an evaluation, including moral evaluation, and endorsing it. Hence, it is entirely possible, or so he says, for a theory to take into account Dworkin's function of law, etc., and still remain general, that is, not committed to any specific normative position. Perhaps much of the controversy attaching to the issue can be attributed to a conflation between what is desirable and what is moral. Stephen Guest could be said to be a prime culprit in this regard. We have already discussed his point of view. Julie Dixon expresses agreement with what she perceives as Perry's thesis, namely, the conceptual analyzed perspectives on the law's normative necessitates moral evaluation. She contends instead that a process of indirect evaluation can be used to analyze the notion Perry alludes to. By this, she means that an indirectly evaluative proposition such as X is important does not entail a directly evaluation proposition that the same X is good. She takes the example of an agnostic observing a Roman Catholic Mass. Such an observer may evaluate which rituals are important or desirable in the light of the Mass's purposes and objectives, but this will not amount to endorsing such a ritual as morally desirable or undesirable or otherwise good or bad. Indeed, the observer is free not to adopt any position on this. Brian Leiter tackles the desirable moral conflation by making a distinction between epistemic and moral values. The first category entails norms like evidentiary adequacy, simplicity, explanatory consilience, and other truth conducive desiderata, which are desirable not because of their moral content but because they help us acquire knowledge. According to him, understanding notions like obligation and authority in terms of these epistemic values is enough, and any middle ground between descriptive and normative, such as Dixon's indirect evaluation, is not really necessary or called for. At this point, we move to Jules Coleman's conception of negative and positive positivism. Jules Coleman's distinction between negative and positive positivism is important because in many ways it helps us understand later concepts like Waluchow's inclusive positivism. The idea first appeared in a 1982 article and was subsequently included in his book Markets, Morals and the Law. Just like Perry developed his idea by using heart as a target, so did Coleman expound on his perspectives through a target, in this case his perception of Dworkin's claims about heart's positivism. Coleman begins from the rule of recognition. This he describes as ambiguous because it features both what he calls epistemic and semantic senses. In its first sense, the rule of recognition is used as a standard to identify, validate or discover a law within a legal system. In the second sense, the rule specifies the criteria to be satisfied by a norm before being recognized as a law. He further advances the possibility that a rule may be a rule of recognition in one but not in the other sense, since the rule one employs to determine the law need not be the same rule as the one that makes law determine it. Regrettably, he does not further dilate on this point or provide any example. Turning to the separability thesis, he points out that it needs to be distinguished from the claim that the law of a community is one thing and its morality another. The latter he describes as seriously ambiguous and construable in at least three different senses: A, that there exists no convergence between a community's law and morality; B, the laws of a community can be identified without reference to morality; or C, that in no community can a moral proposition be used as a truth condition for any proposition of law. The last he claims is what Dworkin is anxious to ascribe to positivism, and the validity of this ascription commands some prominence in Coleman's exegesis. Coleman characterizes as a negative positivism a form of positivism where the rule of recognition is constrained by the separability thesis, that is, a belief that at least one legal system may be conceived where the rule of recognition does not entail any moral criterion. On the other hand, positive positivism, which forms Dworkin's favorite target, involves construing the rule of recognition in terms of the belief that a moral condition cannot ever determine the legal validity of a norm. The point of this is, negative positivism is not threatened by Dworkin's claims about principles counting as legal norms in hard cases. Much of the debate between positivists and Dworkin appear rather foolish unless there is a version of positivism that makes Dworkin's criticism, if not compelling, at least relevant. His contention is that a form of positive positivism may be derived that is capable of overcoming Dworkin's objections. He begins from the suggestion that the rule of recognition can be framed so as to have one clause devoted to the principles of morality. This is necessary because not all moral principles can be legally binding, for which some test or other mode to distinguish binding and non-binding moral principles must be identified. Coleman proposes a rule of recognition stipulating that a rule is a legal rule if it possesses characteristic C, and a moral principle legally binding if it features characteristic C1. Now, the interesting thing about this rule of recognition is that everything that Dworkin ascribes to positivism, other than the model of rules, survives. By model of rules is meant here the thesis that the only standards possessing the right pedigree amounts to a law. Now, first, the rule of recognition in its semantic sense holds good because the legality of a norm does not depend on whether it is a rule or a principle, but on whether it satisfies one or the other criteria condition stated in the rule of recognition. The separability thesis also remains valid just so long as one conceivable norm in one conceivable system is based as a law on satisfying a C clause rather than a C1 clause. The interesting thing about this rule of recognition is that everything that Dworkin ascribes to positivism, other than the model of rules, survives. By model of rules is meant here the thesis that the only standards possessing the right pedigree amount to a law. First, the rule of recognition in its semantic sense holds good because the legality of a norm does not depend on whether it is a rule or a principle, but on whether it satisfies one or the other condition stated in the rule of recognition. The separability thesis also remains valid just so long as one conceivable norm in one conceivable system is validated and a law on satisfying a C clause rather than C1 clause. Lastly, even Hart's conjecture about judicial discretion in Hart cases survives Dworkin challenge because since only a determinate set of norms, both legal rules and moral principles, are accorded legal recognition, a case may well arise that is not covered by either a legal or a moral standard, which will compel the judge to apply a non-legal standard in order to reach a decision. Lastly, inclusive and exclusive positivism. The roots of the inclusive legal positivism thesis also lie in the philosophy of H.L.A. Hart. Though in common with several of the ideas discussed here, its development was taken by his students. W.J. Waluchow is regarded as a leading proponent of this thesis, along with notables like Jules Corman and Matthew Kramer. On the other hand, Joseph Raz is known as a defender of this exclusive positivism thesis, as are Scott Shapiro and Andre Marmor. But what exactly are these theses? The central idea behind inclusive positivism is simple. It postulates that the legal validity may depend on moral as well as formal criteria. Or to put another way, the rule of recognition may feature moral criteria along with others. Several examples can be derived from the Indian constitution and Indian constitutional law. For example, after Manika Gandhi versus Union of India, it is well settled that the right to life and personal liberty can be curtailed not by any procedure established by law, but only a procedure that is also just, fair and reasonable. Hence, when examining the validity of, say, a new preventive detention law, that part of the rule of recognition that is represented by part 3 of the constitution will take into account not only objectively determinable social facts, such as whether it has been passed by both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha with sufficient numbers of present members present in voting, but also moral criteria like whether it conforms to established standards of justice, fairness and reasonability. Indeed, some theorists have adopted an inclusive position simply because they find it a more natural position. Waluchow, for example, describes the exclusive position as simply counterintuitive. It seems quite an odd with our ordinary understanding of a constitutional document like the Canadian Charter. The exclusivist position is much more nuanced and complicated, and all the more so because it appears counterintuitive, as we just discussed. Let us take Raz's version. Before we start discussing it, it's essential that we familiarize ourselves at least briefly with this treatment of what he calls practical reasons. Practical reasons are nothing but reasons for doing or not doing something. For example, we may switch on a fan to get relief from the heat. Likewise, when we don't need the fan, we switch it off so as not to waste electricity. Now, at times these reasons may clash. Suppose I feel like eating an ice cream in hot weather, even though I have little money to spare. Here the reason for spending money, namely the desire for ice cream, clashes with the reasons for not spending, that is financial prudence, and ultimately whichever way I decide will depend on which reason I consider weightier or more persuasive. At times, one or more such competing reasons may be moral in nature. An example is when I come across a red light when I am in a hurry. Considerations of civic sense and road safety dictate that I stop till the light changes. On the other hand, shortage of time may tempt me to jump the light. The reasons which compete with one another and the weightier of which prevails over the others is what Raz terms first order reasons. Some reasons, however, work in a different manner. The evening before an important examiner, preparations will be the only thing on my mind. In such circumstances, one reason for action, namely my exam performance, becomes so significant that it becomes ipso facto a reason not to act on competing reasons, that is, a reason to exclude from contemplation all other practical reasons. So, if my friends try to tempt me into going out with them for a dinner or movie, I shall surely tell them to get lost. And why? Because my desire to do well in the next day's exam is so strong as to be a reason not to do anything other than study. Such reasons, which act as reasons not to act on other reasons, or which act as reasons not to act on other reasons or exclude others from considerations, Raz terms second order reasons or exclusionary reasons. So, how is this relevant to our discussion on positivism? The connection lies in this manner. According to Hart, laws are authoritative statements, that is, they claim authority unto themselves. Anything that claims authority must function as an exclusionary reason. Obeying or jumping a red light is not merely a matter of morality versus expediency. Let us not forget that there is a legal consideration attached to this issue. And by rights, the mere fact that jumping a red light is illegal ought to exclude all other reasons for considerations, because it carries the authority of law. Now, when a law incorporates morality qua morality, it does not replace the first order reason that already applies on us. It merely tells us not to act on that first order moral reason that was already imposed on us. This is manifestly inconsistent with the idea that law, in order to claim authority, has to provide exclusionary reasons for action. Lastly, the conclusion. In this discussion, we encountered three new developments pertaining to positivism, all of which have directly or indirectly emanated from Hart's contribution to jurisprudence. The first entails a distinction between substantive and methodological positivism. Substantive positivism is effectively the positivism we are familiar with, that is, the separation of law and morals. So, it involves little that is new to us. Hence, not much need exists for us to discuss it here. Methodological positivism involves the separation of morality from the study of law rather than the law itself. It presents to us certain new unprecedented issues which have spawned a considerable debate, which is why it is expedient to address it in detail here. In the light of the debate we examined earlier, the question still remains: what can be said about the status of methodological positivism? Certainly, in debates of this sort, an authoritatively correct answer is usually not possible. But we may at least recognize the following with some degree of assurance. First, the distinction between substantive and methodological positivism appears to be insightful, to the extent that they entail separate undertakings and one does not follow from the other. Similarly, and secondly, the extent that they entail separate understandings. Secondly, while Perry's perceived inadequacies in Hart's account of law can possibly sustain further investigation, his contention that conceptual analysis from the internal point of view must be undertaken either from a skeptical point of view or from a Dworkinian one appears debatable. This is because, as so many have pointed out, evaluation, even moral evaluation, can be undertaken without some or the other moral position. Consequently, there is a good reason to suggest that the idea of methodological positivism, that is to say, engaging in a general morally neutral descriptive account of legal phenomena, may not necessarily be a futile quest. Moreover, this engagement will remain meaningful even if the substantive criteria of positivism are diluted to take into account norms of morality, such as what inclusive positivism, which we shall examine in detail later, contemplates. Apart from this distinction, we also encountered the notion of negative and positive positivism. This was devised in response largely to Dworkin's classic attack on positivism. Negative positivism involves constraining the rule of recognition by the separability thesis, which carries the implication that all rules of recognition need not necessarily entail moral criteria. Positive positivism, on the other hand, entails the belief that no moral consideration can ever form a part of the rule of recognition. This position is conceptually similar to the exclusive positivism of Raz and Shapiro. Coleman then proposes a version of positive positivism, one where the rule of recognition uses criterion C to validate rules as legal and criterion C1 to similarly validate moral norms as legally binding. As he claims, the advantage of this construct is that it satisfactorily deals with mostly all that Dworkin identifies as shortcomings of positivism. Lastly, we explore the notion that inclusive and exclusive positivism. Conceptually, inclusive positivism resembles Cole's negative positivism to a large extent, except that it is broader in ambit. It entails the belief that legal validity may depend on moral as well as formal considerations. Proponents of this theory find it attractive because it closely resembles the working of real life constitutions. Raz's argument in favor of exclusive positivism stems from his concept of the authority of law. This, to his mind, must prove to agents second order or exclusionary reasons for compliance. And this requirement is frustrated when the law incorporates within it norms of morality qua morality. These, in brief, are a sample of the kind of developments that have taken place within the framework of positivism as a direct consequence of Hart's contributions. Certainly, they are not exhaustive of such developments, and doubtless other theorists have also in their own ways taken off from Hart's core philosophy and reached new conclusions. Considerations of space, however, compel us to limit ourselves to these three forms, arguably the more prominent among all others. Thank you.